Hello friends, it's your Lakshmipathy here. Today we are going to discuss about insulation coordination. So let's review few things about it. Why it is important? What are the things involved? Where we will use this concept and all? So insulation coordination is the process of knowing the insulation levels of power system components. In other words, it is the process of determining the insulation strength of the equipment. Insulation coordination is a series of steps used to select the dielectric strength of equipment in relation to the operating voltages and the transient over voltages which can appear on the system for which the equipment is intended. Many factors are taken into account during the selection process, including the service environment, insulation resistant characteristics, arrestor characteristics, and in some cases, probability of potential surges. So what are all the keywords we will use in our presentation? Electrical, power system, subconstruction, EHV substation, insulation coordination, power system studies, maintenance, high voltage, surge arrestor, lightning. So these are all some of the points we will use in our discussion. So it is a selection of suitable insulation levels of various components in any electrical system and their rational arrangement. It is required to ensure insulation shall withstand all normal stresses and majority of abnormal ones, efficient discharge of over voltages due to internal or external causes. B by D shall be only due to external causes. B by D shall be at such places where least damage is caused. So here we have determination of insulation coordination. Steps in the determination of insulation coordination. So first, determination of live insulation, selection of BIL and insulation levels of other equipment, selection of lightning arrestors. These are the main things. So we will deal with many terms. So let's review a few things. Definition: flashover voltages, dry flashover voltage, dry for power frequency voltage, which will cause the flashover of the insulation. We have wet flashover voltage, power frequency voltage, which will cause the flashover when sprayed with the water of a resistance, say for 9000 to 11000 ohms centimeters, drawn from a source of supply at a temperature within 10 degrees centigrade of the ambient temperature in the neighborhood of insulation under testing, and directed at an angle of 45 degrees. The volume of water being equivalent to precipitation of 0.305 centimeter per minute. Yeah, this is the definition for wet flashover voltage. We have others also. Impulse flashover voltage: the voltage which will cause flashover of an insulation when subjected to 1.250 microsecond. This is the tail duration, tail and peak duration of the impulse. So generally British standard says 150 microseconds, American standard says 1.540 microseconds, but generally 1.250 is the standard. So we have other things, a basic insulation level, BIL we will say. What is this? The crest voltage of a standard wave that will not cause flashover of the insulation is referred to as basic insulation level. Basic impulse insulation voltage levels are expressed in an impulse crest voltage with a standard wave not longer than 1.250 microseconds. Yeah, this is the general strength. Equipment insulation as tested shall be equal to or above BIL. Yeah, that's what we will test the jobs. So impulse spark power volt time characteristics, this is one of the important thing. This characteristic is obtained by plotting time which elapses between the moment of voltage wave is applied and the moment of spark over on system. So voltage at the moment of spark over occurring on the wave fronts, occurring on the wave peaks, crest of voltage for spark over occurring on the wave tail. These are the three points. So these characteristics is established by means of a 1/50 impulse wave, a line drawn meeting the three B by G values in the characteristics. Proper insulation coordination will ensure that the voltage time curve of any equipment will lie above the volt time curve of the protective equipment, say the lightning arrestor. This is most important thing. So we have line insulation. Extra high voltage line can be made lightning proof by efficient shielding, low tower faulting resistance equal to or less than 10 ohms, and shielding angle also there. Transmission line up to 220 kV, we will use a shielding angle 30 degree. For 400 kV and above, we will use a 20 degree shielding angle. Line insulation shall be sufficient to prevent a flashover from power frequency voltages and the switching surges. It shall take into consideration the local unfavorable circumstances which decrease the flashover voltage. For example, rain, dirt, insulation, pollution. There are some other aspects also. We should take care of those things. We have over voltage factors. Yeah, line voltages. Say for example, 220 kV and 400 kV. So switching surge flashover. We will use a 6.5 V and a 5 V. Power frequency flashover. It can be dry or wet. We will use a 0.3 and a 3.3. So VPN is phase to neutral voltage RMS, and add one or two more insulators for each string. So that is just a safer measure. So to take care of one disc in the string becoming defective, facilitate hotline maintenance up to 220 kV line, one disc for each string, 400 kV line, two discs for each string. So we will use as a precautionary or extra. So FOV, flashover voltage of disc. Say for example, this is the disc. So number of disc we have here, 9, 10, 14, 15, 25. So we have dry FOV and we have a wet FOV. So dry FOV, these are the voltages that can withstand, and wet FOV, these are the voltages that can withstand. This is the impulse voltages, generally it can withstand. That is standard full wave impulse. So for say 25 number of disc for 1280 FOV, it can go for a 2145 impulse. That's as per we discussed 6.6, 0.3 or something. So recommended insulation levels of a line. So we have normal system voltage 132 kV, 220 kV and 400 kV. For this, the phase voltages will be 76, 127 and 231. It's simply divided by root 3. Switching over voltages, so what is that? Generally, we will take 6.5 times. Otherwise, we can say 6 times. So this is the switching voltages. So what disc we need here? 5, 9 and 13. This is the number of discs generally we will consider on these lines. So we have similarly 132, 220 and 400 kV. We have power frequency also. So power frequency we will take 3 times. So number of disc required 6, 10 and 20. Number of disc recommended is 1 disc, 1 or 2 disc more than that, 7, 11, 22. Generally in practice we are considering 9 or 10, 13 or 14, 23 or 24. That's the thing actually. So tower faulting resistance, generally we will keep 10 ohms. So severest lightning discharge, that is generally 50 kiloamp RMS. Impulse strength of insulation. So we will just calculate the impulse strength, that is the root 2 into 50 kiloamp into 10 cube. So and 10 is the resistance. We will get 700 kV. As per the table, for 7 disc, the impulse FOV 695 kV peak. For better performance tower forcing, resistance will be brought down. So generally, if you bring down the resistance, then that would be good. So for 132 kV, best is 7 ohms. So line insulation is not directly related to the insulation of equipment within the substation. Impulse flashover voltage of a line insulation determines the highest surge voltage that can travel into the substation. Current through lightning arrestor can be calculated. We have some surge impedance of line, surge voltage arriving over the line. These are the two parameters we will use for our calculation. So coordination of line insulation and substation insulation. Discharge voltage of the LA on that current is the basic perspective level of a substation equipment. Discharge voltage across LA varies with surge current. So this is the table, basic insulation table, 132, 220 and 400 kV. These are all the highest system voltages. These are nominal voltage. So we have impulse here, a full wave impulse 650 and 1050. We have a reduced insulation, generally 60% to some 75% we can take reduced insulation. So we have 1 minute power frequency PF 275 and 460 kV, and reduced one similarly 230, 395, 680 and 630 values. So reduced insulation is used where the system is effectively earthed. That system is effectively earthed, we can go for this reduced one. So insulation levels of equipment, we have transformers, isolators, instrument transformers are manufactured for the standard insulation level. Sometimes transformers are manufactured for a one step lower insulation level for the sake of economy. LS will be designed for a still a lower level. Where LS are provided right on the top of the transformer, some of the equipment may lie well outside the protective zone of the LA. So protective zone is determined based on withstand of level of the equipment, discharge volts of LA, distance between LA and the equipment. Such equipment shall be designed for one step higher BIL. Generally, BIL of substation equipment other than transformer are designed for 10% higher than that of transformer. That's the true, that is the tendency generally we will follow in the practice. Insulation levels of the equipment. BIL of open poles of a disconnect switch shall be 10 to 15% higher than that provided between poles and edge, because there is chances of a flashover or something. So we should take care of those things. We have EHV system must be designed to operate under stress associated not only with the normal operating power frequency voltage, but also those caused by transient over voltage also. These transient over voltage arise principally from lightning over voltage and switching operations. The former is a predominant in system at 100 kV and below. Switching over voltages are concerned in a system from 220 kV and above. So from 220 kV onwards, it's better to take care of switching over voltage. So we have insulation coordination over voltage. Say for example, UN is a line to line normal RMS voltage. UM is a highest system voltage line to line. So you take the ground voltage with peak value, peak of RMS value. So that is nothing but root 2 by the root 3 into UM. So any voltage higher than root 2 by root 3 UM is called over voltage. That's true, right? That's true. Anything beyond the maximum sine wave peak, that is we call it as a over voltage. In addition, temporary over voltages also occur at power and harmonic frequencies at times for a considerable time under certain conditions. The insulation strength and characteristics of various components of a system, including those of voltage limiting devices, must be selected and relating to those stresses to reduce the frequency of supply interruptions, to reduce component failures. The selected level of voltage shall be low enough to be occasionally and economically acceptable. We have IEC 71, which covers the insulation coordination. We have part 1, which it gives the definition and principles. Part 2, guidance of selection of rules, electric strength of the plant, electric strength of LAs or protective spark gaps. We have part 3 also. It gives the phase-to-phase insulation coordination, complementary to part 1 and 2, standard phase-to-phase insulation levels for voltage up to and above 300 kV. Voltage stresses in service and clearances in air, we can see in part 3. So what data we need for doing all these things? So we need field data on lightning induced and the switching surges appearing on the system, establishing insulation strength of various insulation components of our system through lab tests. So causes of over voltages. So what are the causes? Phase to earth faults, it is assumed that the resulting temporary voltages will not exceed 1.4 times for solidly earthed networks, 1.7 times for resistance earthed networks, 2 times for reactance earth networks. This is the consideration generally over voltages. So load rejection, supplying capacitive current through a large inductive reactance, example a smaller generator connected to a long cable or overhead line. These are the some of the load rejection. Ferro resonance also there, it also can cause over voltage. interchange of stored energy for a series or parallel combination of inductive and capacitive reactance. So that we have Baranti effect also, receiving end voltage greater than sending end voltage under no load or light load conditions. By careful design and natural earthing sustain the overvoltages involving resonance and arcing ground faults, we can eliminate it. Below 145 kV method of earthing will normally determine the level temporary overvoltages. Yeah, this is also true. If you are reducing the resistance of earthing resistance, then overvoltage generally will be low. We have switching surges. They are short duration and irregular form. Typically, switching impulse standard form is 250 by 2500 second, time to crest and time to half the value. Yeah, it is not like your normal impulse. Magnitude of internally operated switching surges are related to system operating voltage. In a system where CBs are not subjected to multi-restriking, the switching surges will rarely exceed 3 per unit. Yeah, it won't go beyond 3 per unit. 2.5 per unit would be typical maximum based on which the discharge duty of a LES is assessed. However, in systems above 300 kV, it may be necessary to suppress maximum switching surges to 2 per unit or less by the installation of shunt reactor or a closing resistors on the circuit breakers, because maximum 2 times is a good one. We have resonance effects also. For voltage levels below 300 kV, resonance effects occur when switching transformer, when switching cable and overhead line combination, between lumped capacitive and reactive elements and overhead lines, charging long lines without shunt reactor compensation. These are some resonance effects. It may cause more voltage on the network. We have ferrite resonance encountered on a transformer failure greater than 5 to 10 km in length. When one feeder or transformer on double circuit is switched out but parallel feeder remains energized, the dead circuit draw energy by captive coupling from the parallel line circuit, which resonates with the transformer impedance at a subharmonic frequency. We have operation procedures such as opening the line isolator at the transformer end on the disconnected circuit will eliminate the problem. We can do that. Mode of action of flashover on a line. So let's discuss this. A lightning flash can impress over voltage on a overhead line by induction when it discharges to a closed line, by direct contact on the line either to the earth structure or to the phased conductor. So induced voltage surge. A closed flash to ground about 14 meter away can induce a voltage rise on phase conductors. The highest amplitude normally associated is in the region of 200 kV. Significant in case of low voltage lines. At 11 kV, estimated that it accounts for almost 90% of all faults. Little significance on lines of 275 kV and above. We have direct stroke. A direct stroke can be to the earthed tower top or on phase conductor. Stroke on earthed lower top for transmission of shielded design is innocuous. Rise in potential caused by passage of current through tower impedance to earth will be less than withstand strength of the line. So direct stroke. However, the rise in potential can be severe and exceed withstand capability if tower footing resistance is too high or rate of rise of current exceeds a certain level. Flashover also may occur. Through the system voltage, losses is the frequency of flashover. Direct stroke on phase conductor may occur if there is a shielding failure, so that is a stroke avoids earth wire and lands on line conductor or something. Discharge current flows equally in both directions. Impedance to earth is half the surge impedance of the conductor. For example, in 400 kV line, we have Z0 175 ohms. Voltage rise is sufficient to cause failure of line insulation. Minimum critical current for flashover is 2V by Z, where V is a minimum flashover voltage for 1 over 50 wave. At flashover, the impedance through which the discharge current flows drops abruptly from Z0 by 2 to the impedance of tower X arm tower footing. Surge propagation. Let's see the surge propagation. Surge waves are propagated at the velocity of light along the conductor. On arrival at substation equipment, there is a get stressed. Rod gaps and surge arrestors provide necessary protection. Waves are subjected to considerable attenuations due to losses both in the conductor, ohmic losses, and some coronal losses. So, lightning discharge we can classify into two types, stroke A and stroke B. Let's discuss about stroke A. These are produced by charged cloud which induces a charge on the stationary object such as high buildings, etc. Charge distribution causes a concentration of potential at the topmost point, electrostatic stress being great at the point of ionization of surrounding atmosphere takes place. Dielectric strength of surrounding air decreases, giving an easy path to lightning stroke. Decrease in dielectric strength of surrounding air takes considerable time. We have stroke B. A, B and C are three clouds with A and C positively charged, B negatively charged. When there is stroke between A and B, the charge on C becomes free and immediately indiscriminately strikes on any object on the ground. For stroke B, there is no timeline. Stroke B may completely ignore highest building and strike bare ground. No protection can be arranged against stroke B. Stroke A can be made safe by channeling the charge through a lightning conductor placed on the top of the building. We have static induced charges. An overhead conductor accumulates statically induced charge. When a charge cloud comes above, when the cloud is swept away, charge on the conductor is released. The charge travels on either side, giving rise to two traveling waves. The earth wire does not prevent such surges. So, what are the calculations for lightning strokes? Power voltage due to lightning stroke, we can get surge impedance of the line say Zs, discharge current Ig, power voltage due to stroke is nothing but Id into Zs. However, current travels in both directions, power voltage, so we can take half of the current. When lightning strikes over a wire or a tower, the power voltage is we have to add Ldi by dt. Where impedance of Ze is the impedance of earth wire and Lc is inductance of the line conductor. So, protection against lightning. Protection of transmission lines from direct strokes. Protection of power stations and substations from direct strokes. Protection of electrical equipment from traveling waves. These are some protection methods. So, let's discuss protection of transmission lines against direct strokes. It is most harmful, effective protection required, shielding to prevent lightning from striking the electrical conductors. There shall be adequate drain facilities so that the charge can be grounded without affecting insulators or line conductors. Otherwise, it will cause a puncture of all the things. Design shall consist of general wire of adequate mechanical strength to provide shielding for a line conductor. They shall also non-corrosive. Resistance of ground wire shall be low for better protection against a direct stroke. And the adequate clearances, we should take care line conductor and tower, line conductor and airs, clearance between line conductor and ground wire, all through this span, including mid span, point of a lowest span, everywhere we have to take care of this. And tower footing resistance shall be too low. And angle of protection, shielding angle between the normal passing through the ground wire and the line joining the supported center points of outer conductor and ground wire. It shall be 30 degree for 132 kV and 220 kV lines and 20 for 400 kV lines. So, effect of number of earth wires. In the absence of a ground wire, when there is a charge cloud over transmission line without any ground wire, there will be two capacitances between cloud and conductor and between conductor and air, C2 and C1. So, let's calculate individual voltage on the line. So, C1 by C1 plus C2 into EC. When ground wire is present, it increases capacitance between conductor and earth, that is C1. C1 decreases individual voltage on the line. It is observed that the presence of ground wire reduces individual voltage on line to off value. For two ground wires, the individual voltage comes down to 1/3. Presence of two ground wires also provides better shielding also. Shielding angle also would be good. Disadvantage with a ground wire. Disadvantage with a ground wire, highest line cost. Probable direct starting between line conductor and ground wire when later gets cut. If anything gets cut, chances of a short over is there. In 400 kV system, transmission lines, towers will have through earth wires. Two earth wires will have. There are some alternate methods of protection also. Even after providing ground and reducing the likely induced voltages, harmful voltages can still develop. That is the thing here. Lightning arrestors act as additional protective devices by bypassing the surges to ground. A protective tube is a fiber tube with an electrode at the earth end, fitted directly below the conductor. The R-type electrode on the top of the tube forms a series gap with the conductor. The lower electrodes is solidly grounded in case of surge on the top conductor. On the conductor, an arc develops between conductor and the top electrode of the tube. Arc shifts within the tube and vaporizes some of the fiber of tube wall to emit gases which will quench the arc. This tube successfully prevents restriking also. The breakdown voltage of tube shall be less than flashover voltage of the insulation. Protection against traveling waves. The traveling waves causes the following damages. High peak voltage of surge may cause flashover in the internal winding or external flashover between terminals of the equipment. Steep wave front may cause internal flashover between turns of the transformer. And steep wave front resulting into resonance and high voltage may cause internal or external flashover, causing building up of oscillations in the equipment. Protective equipment, we have LAs and surge diverters. They are connected between line and earth. For taking care. So, what is the action of surge diverter? A traveling wave reaches surge diverter and attains a prefixed voltage. A spark is formed across the gap. The diversion provides a low impedance path to earth. The surge impedance of the line limits the amplitude of current flowing to earth to prevent breakdown of insulation. Important aspect is that the surge diverter shall provide low impedance path to earth only when traveling surge reaches the surge diverters. At other times, no, it's not opening or operating. It shall absorb any current during normal operation for power voltage surges. It means that it shall not function at power frequencies, but function only when abnormal frequencies are applied. That's the main theme of surge arresters. So, surge diverters. When there is a discharge through them, they shall be capable of carrying the discharge current for some time interval. After the power voltage discharge, it must be capable of interrupting normal frequency current from flowing to earth as soon as the voltage reaches below the breakdown value. We have switching power voltage protection also in the substations. Operation of breakers causes transient power voltages. Power voltage value varying between 1.1 times to 6 times based on switching duty and the type of circuit breaker. Power voltage occurs mainly due to the exchange of energy between system inductance of Li square and the system capacitance of Cv square. Power voltage occurs during the opening of circuits and closing of long EHV lines. Most severe power voltages occur during closing of unloaded transmission line. Preventive measure, provision of pre-insertion resistors around 400 to 800 ohms per phase, we can do that. So, simultaneous closing of lines at both ends we can do. Using shunt reactors and surge arrestors also we can use for switching protection. So we have switching over voltages in substations, switching duty of a circuit breaker, opening of capacitor, bank current, capable cable charging circuits, filter bank, these are some of the things. So switching of shunt capacitor banks used for a power factor correction. Generally, we have power factor correction. Whenever you are opening, there are chances of switching. Use of free strike, free circuit breaker for capacitor switching duty. What is the phenomena here? Restrike in a circuit breaker is giving over voltage. Yeah, that is the thing, mainly they will give over voltage. So we have EHV lines, closing of unloaded lines, closing of charged lines, auto reclosing of circuit breaker. So in long EHV transmission, we will use this use of pre-closing resistors with circuit breakers and use of lightning arresters, use of shunt reactors in transmission lines. These are the remedial action. So traveling waves travel to and fro, giving rise to a switching surge. We have some methods for reducing switching over voltages. So switching operation causing over voltage and how we will reduce it. Energizing and uncharged line. So high voltage shunt reactors are connected to line to reduce power frequency over voltages. And one more, elimination of trapped charged on the line. Line shunting after opening by means of earthing switch. Reduction of current chopping. Opening resistors, resistance switching with the circuit breaker. You did only with the ABCB. So we have some more parameters. Reducing the switching over voltages due to closing. Single stage pre-closing resistor insertion with CB, or two stage pre-closing resistor insertion with CB, or closing resistors in between circuit breaker and shunt reactor. We have another method, reducing switching over voltages by improved switching sequence. We can have a synchronous switching of three poles, simultaneous operation of circuit breakers at both end of line. That also we can do. Use of surge arresters while closing of a line, while disconnecting reactor. These are the things we can use surge arresters. We have rod gaps or coordinating gaps also. They are used on insulators, equipment and bushings. So conducting rods are provided between a line terminal and edge terminal with an adjustable gap. That is, we will say air insulation. Rods are of 12 mm dia approximately. These are mostly we will use on transformers. The gap is adjusted to break down at about 20% below the flashover voltage of insulation. Spark power causes a dead short circuit. Voltage of phase with respect to ground falls very low. The rod gaps are no more used consequent to development of surge arresters. So whenever we have surge arresters, so we are almost not using rod gaps, but still like arcing guns we can use on bushings as a additional protection or other measures. So what are the over voltage in a network and remedies? We have surges. The causes are lightning strokes on overhead lines or substation. So we have some effects like line insulation flashover or puncture. The traveling wave reaches substations. The insulation of equipment is stressed by impulse surge. So we can use some remedies for this. Use of ground wire, surge diverters, earthing of towers, lightning mast. We can use lightning mast also. And for such switching surges. So for causes for switching surges is breaking inductive circuit. The energy stored inductance gives rise a voltage across the capacitor. Switching of capacitive, line charging of current gives rise to over voltage due to the restrike. Closing of EHV line. These are the some causes. So what is the effect? Wave travels from circuit breaker to both sides. Transmission line insulator stressed. Terminal operator's insulation stressed. So what we can do for this? Use of opening resistors with the CB. Use of restrike free CB, use of pre-insertion resistors with CB. These are some three options we have. So we have resonance also. The fault causing resonance between inductance and capacitance in a part of circuit. Any faults are there, then there is chances of this resonance. Very high impact and voltage surges occur. Insulation failure likely to occur. So we can use filters to eliminate any harmonics. So we have another phenomena, traveling waves. High voltage waves gets reflected on reaching a junction or end. So the impact is reflected waves gets superimposed for initial value, initial wave, and voltage may rise for several times the normal voltage. And remedies for this are a proper switching sequence. And we have sustained power frequency over voltage. This is due to poor voltage control. The causes can be poor voltage control, and the effects are failure of transformers and rotating machines. They can fail due to this over voltage. So remedies, proper voltage control, we can take care. And we have rod gaps also, device for protecting all the lightning over voltages across insulator string, bushing insulators, we can do that. So one thing is difficult to coordinate. They will create a dead short circuit, and of course these are very cheap. We have overhead lines, overhead ground wires, earthed wires, above overhead lines. So above the substation area, we can apply these things. They provide effective protection against direct strokes on line conductors, towers, substation equipment. And another device is a vertical mast in substations. So we have to apply these things in substations. So instead of providing overhead shielding wires, so we don't need to provide overhead shielding wires. This vertical masting is maybe good. Another one is a lightning mast or a rods earthed above tall buildings. We will use this protect buildings against direct strokes. Angle of protection generally will be 30 degree. And we have surge arresters also. These we can use for protection. So where we will use these surge arresters? Our incoming lines in each substation, near terminals of transformers and generators, near motors and generator terminals. So diverts over voltage to earth without causing short circuit. Used at every voltage level in the substation and for each line. So surge absorbers also we have. What is the impact of it? Where we will use it? Near rotating machines connected between phase and ground, we can use these surge absorbers. Resistance capacitance combination absorbs the over voltage surge and reduces stiffness of wave. This is combination of R and C only. It will just absorb it. So lightning arrester selection. How we will select the lightning arrester? To determine magnitude of power frequency, phase to ground voltage expected at the proposed arrester location during phase to ground faults or other abnormal conditions which cause higher voltages to ground than normal. And to make a tentative selection of power frequency voltage rating of the arrester, we can use the following steps. To select an impulse current likely to discharge through the arrester. To determine maximum arrester discharge voltage for impulse current and type of arrester selected, and establish full wave impulse voltage withstand level of the equipment to be protected, and make certain that the maximum arrester discharge voltage is below the full wave impulse withstand level of equipment insulation to be protected by adequate margin. To establish the separation limit between arrester and the equipment to be protected. And we have some types of earthing. The purpose of selection of voltage rating of LEA, three types of earthing are considered generally. Effective earthing system. A system is effectively earthed if under any fault condition the line to earth voltage of healthy phases do not exceed 80% of the system line to line voltage. Yeah, so this is one case. If in a system all transformers have star connected winding with a neutrally solidly earthed, then the system is effectively earthed. And however, if only few transformers are earthed like that, it is not effectively earthed system. Yeah. Non-effectively earthed system is there. If line to earth voltage in healthy phases in case of fault exceed 80% of line to line voltage but does not exceed 100% of it, the system is called effectively earthed system. And system with a few solidly earthed neutrals. System with a neutral earthed through resistors or reactors of a low ohmic value or earth suppression coils. And we have a isolated or unearthed neutral system. System neutrals are not earthed. Line to earth voltage of a healthy phase exceed 100% of line to line voltage. So this is the third case. So how we will choose the lightning arresters? So here it is tentative selection. Arrester voltage rating shall not be less than the product of highest system voltage and coefficient of earthing. For effectively earthed system, we will take 80%. For non-effectively earthed system, an isolated earthing system, we will take 100%. So this is the limitation generally. For example, in a 220 kV effectively earthed system, 245 kV is the highest voltage. Arrestor coefficient of earthing is 80%. So 196 kV we can take. As per IS 3070, we can take 198 kV. So that is also a good option. By going for higher voltage rating for a surge arrestor, the degree of protection for equipment gets reduced. That also true. We should take care of that. And selection of discharge current. This is the one of the most important thing. This can be calculated from some of the below parameters. We have spark power voltage of our transmission line insulation, surge impedance of the line, residual discharge voltage of LA. So the discharge voltage of LA. So we have IA. The formula is a 2E minus EA by Z. So magnitude of incoming surge voltage, and EA is a residual discharge voltage of an arrestor, and Z is the surge impedance of the line. By using this, we can calculate discharge arrestor discharge current. Generally, these things to be provided by the system studies and people. So in a 220 kV system using 11 insulators, transmission line will not permit a traveling wave of value more than 102 pi kV peak. So as per IS, we have a voltage of LA at a discharge current of 10 kiloamp is 649 kV. So considering the surge impedance, for example, say 450 ohm, maximum value of discharge current of LA is nothing but 2 into, we are just using the formula 2E minus E by 450, 3100 amps. The LA normally in 200 kV system have discharge current rating of 10 kiloamp. So we are getting around 3100 amps only. And selection of arrestor discharge voltage. This is also one of the most important characteristic for determining the protection level being offered. The arrestor discharge voltage shall be less than the BAL of equipment to be for effective protection. Discharge voltage depends again on discharge current, rate of rise of current applied, wave shape of current applied. Discharge voltage of LA increases with a discharge current, but increases is much restricted due to non-linear resistance property. Increase in discharge from 5 kiloamp to 20 kiloamp produces only 25% rise in discharge voltage. Increase in rate of current from 1000 to 5000 amps per microsecond increases discharging voltage by only 35%. So we have some protection margin for LA. Protection margin of LA is nothing but BAL of equipment and maximum discharge voltage of LA. By determining protection level offered by LA 10%. Allowances towards a drop in lead length and manufacturing tolerances shall be allowed. Protective margin shall be 20% of BAL of the equipment when closely located in a 220 kV system. So here is an example, discharge voltage of LA 649 kV, allowing 10% margin protection level, it will be 713, BAL of equipment 900 kV. So protection margin is 187 kp. There is more than 20% of the BAL of 180 kV. So we have a protective margin. Say in American system, average discharge voltage into 1.25 times plus 40 kV extra they will add as a BAL protector. When adequate margin is not available, LAs with a lower rating shall be chosen, taking some risk. So insulation coordination scheme, for example, for a 220 kV system, LA voltage rating is nothing but system highest voltage into coefficient of earthing, 245 into 0.8, so 196 kV. So as per the standard available voltage, which is 198, say discharge current rating 10 kiloamp is assumed. So residual voltage as per standard IS, it is 649 kV peak. So protection level of the LA is nothing but 10% extra, 714 kV. So the margin should be between 20%. So it is nothing but 714 into 1.2, 857 kV choosing standard BIL of 900 kV is a good one. So corresponding power frequency 1 minute test voltage for that is 395 kV. Switching surge flashover voltage is generally 6.5 times will be there, and 825 kV is the key thing. So check it, it is less than BIL of 900 kV. Power frequency or voltage 220 by root 3 into 3, 228 kV RMS. This is less than 395 kV. BIL of CBs, instrument transformer, disconnect switches, etc. So it can be 900 into 1.1 times 990 kV. Choose standard BIL 1175 kV. So this is the thing we can generally choose it. So the LA, our, the LA, we have LA voltage rating here for 132, 220 and 400 kV. These are the highest system voltages. We have adapter rating, it can be 120 or 198 or 336 kV. So establishment of separation limit. When arrestor to be located away from equipment, a traveling wave coming into station to location to the discharge voltage of the arrestor, proximity to transformer or breakers. Transformers is the most expensive price. Repair to transformer is costly and the higher revenue loss. Transformers are always at the end of a circuit where voltage regulation. For circuit breakers and disconnecting switches, flashover distance between terminals when in open position greater than between terminals and ground. Surge in excess to insulation strength will flash over to ground without damaging the equipment. At best, there can be only outage. By reducing BIL of transformer, savings in the cost of insulation can be obtained, not possible in case of a CB or a disconnection switches. Hence, a set of LDAs shall be closer to transformers. This is generally a good one. So finally, we have location of lightning arresters. The electrical circuit length between LA and the transformer bushing terminal, including a lead length in meters per effectively earthed, should not exceed the below limits. For 132 kV, for 550 BIL, it should be 35 meter. It should not be more than that. For 65 BIL, it can be 45. Similarly, for 220 kV and 400 kV, it should be more closer to the transformer. Yeah, this is about the insulation coordination, guys. I hope the content, whatever we discussed, is helpful to you. If you have any questions or ask anything, then please comment in comment section. Thank you. Thanks for watching. We will meet in next video.